أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لخلق السماوات والأرض أكبر من خلق الناس ولكن أكثر الناس لا يؤمنون. وما يستوي الأعمى والبصير والذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات ولا المسيء قليلا ما يتذكرون. إن الساعة لآتية لا ريب فيها ولكن أكثر الناس لا يؤمنون. وقال ربكم ادعوني أستجب لكم. إن الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي سيدخلون جهنم داخرين. الله الذي جعل لكم الليل لتسكنوا فيه والنهار مبصرا. إن الله لذو فضل على الناس ولكن أكثر الناس لا يشكرون. ذلكم الله ربكم خالق كل شيء لا إله إلا هو فأنى تؤفكون. كذلك يوفك الذين كانوا بآيات الله يجحدون. الله الذي جعل لكم الأرض قرارا والسماء بناء وصوركم فأحسن صوركم ورزقكم من الطيبات. ذلكم الله ربكم فتبارك الله رب العالمين. هو الحي لا إله إلا هو فادعوه مخلصين له الدين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. صدق الله العظيم.
ما شاء الله ما شاء الله ما شاء الله.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام الأتمان الأكملان على خير خلق الله أجمعين وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا. ثم أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for making us Muslims first and foremost. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for making us of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for allowing us to gather in one of His houses. And we know the various hadith and virtues that have come in the religion of Islam as it relates to gathering for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, that for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are malaikatun sayyahin. There are angels who are roaming the earth. Does anybody know? And my reminders tend to be interactive, so that means you have to take part as well. In the Arabic language, what does siyaha mean?
Tourism,
right? So in the hadith, the angels are being referred to as tourists. They are on the earth visiting masajid from place to place, going around. Where are the brothers? Yorkshire, Sheffield, whatever they may be. They're searching for brothers like this who have come to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet ﷺ, he said that they stack upon each other. The angels, they stack upon each other until they reach the skies. When the gathering completes and everybody departs and everybody leaves, they go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِهِمْ. And He knows where they came from. He asks, where did you come from? And they inform Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that it came from a gathering that he was being remembered at. that he Jalla wa Ala was being glorified in, that he Subhanahu wa Ta'ala was being magnified in. And so one of the angels, he informs Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala and he says, one of the people that was there, he was a Abdul Khatta. He never came to participate in the halaqa or the jalsa or the circle or the gathering. He came to meet one of his friends because he wanted to lift home because it was snowy and icy outside. Or he wanted to go out and eat with him and grab a milkshake or bubble tea. This is what he wanted to do. So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, he says, وَلَهُ قَدْ غَفَرْتُ هُمُ الْقَوْمُ لَا يَشْقَى بِهِمْ جَلِيسُهُ. Even that person who had an ill intention, he didn't come to benefit from the gathering. He's just sitting amongst us now, and there could be some of us who came with such intentions. Allah said, even that person I have forgiven. Even that person I have forgiven him. This is a group of people whomsoever sits down with them, he will not leave with any misfortune. Humul qawmu, they are a group. La yashqa bihim jaleesu. Their sitting companion, whoever it may be, he will not leave except with reward, subhanAllah. There was one uncle, this happened in London. He's a Pakistani uncle. And he took his son to the masjid. And you heard the story? The brothers are smiling and laughing. What are you guys laughing about? You tell us the joke later, inshallah. He took his son to the masjid. He took his son to a Somali masjid. They speak Urdu and English as well because they live in England. They don't speak Somali. They can't speak Somali to save their life. He took his son to a Somali masjid. There's a Somali sheikh delivering a lecture speaking in Somali. So the young boy, he said to his dad, what are we doing here? We don't understand what he's saying. And Somali, you know, it sounds rough and tough and it sounds very violent. And it's not violent, but it's a language that has a lot of letters and it's a rich language. That's the best way to describe it. It's a rich language. So to defend myself before the uncles get upset, it is a rich language full of khair. So because of this, it sounds a little bit scary. That's a better way to put it. So the kid, he said, oh dad, what are we doing here? And then he narrated this hadith I narrated. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he forgives anybody that goes to a circle of knowledge. You don't have to understand the same language as the speaker. You don't even have to understand anything he's saying. So long as you are sitting down today, each and every single one of you will be forgiven by Allah. Every single person. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the hadith Qudsi, even if your sins, they reach the sky, أَغْفِرُ لَكَ, I will forgive you وَلَا أُبَالِي, and I will not mind. It will not bother Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you. You could commit the greatest crimes in plural. You could do as much wrong and nonsense as you want. You have a Lord who is Arhamur Rahimeen. And he subhanahu wa ta'ala, before he created the heavens and the earth, he wrote in a special book that's with him, like the authentic hadith mentions, إِنَّ رَحْمَتِي سَبَقَتْ غَضَبِي, that indeed my mercy has preceded my wrath. Do you know, and this topic is on the afterlife, how many gates are for Jannah? How many gates of Jannah are there?
Eight.
Seven. Yes.
Seven.
Seven. Anyone else? Yes.
Seven.
Seven. So are we going with the eight or are we going with the seven?
Seven.
Seven. If you think seven, raise your hands. If you think eight, raise your hands. Why is it only the young brothers? Where are the adults? The adults are not raising their hands. The answer is that it is eight. The trick is to go with Sheikh Muhammad all the time. He's the chef, so he's going to get a rank. The doors of Jannah are eight. But the doors of Jahannam, how many? Seven. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made an additional door for Jannah. There are eight doors for Jannah. And there are seven doors for Jahannam. To prove what I just said, إِنَّ رَحْمَتِي سَبَغَتْ غَضَبِي, that indeed Allah's mercy has preceded His wrath. It's easier for you to get to Jannah than to get to where? To get to Jahannam, the hellfire. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَشْهَدُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ حَقٌّ, I testify that Allah is the truth. وَأَشْهَدُ, and I testify, أَنَّ السَّاعَةَ حَقٌّ, that the hour is true. وَأَنَّ الْجَنَّةَ حَقٌّ, وَأَنَّ النَّارَ حَقٌّ, that the hour is true, and Jannah is true, and Nar is true, and everything is true from the afterlife. This is all true. So how do we ensure that we end up in Al-Jannah? During your time on this earth, the main objective for all of you should be Because you are a believer, you will always be in Jannah. You know this, right?
Yeah.
The believer, لا يخلد في النار. He will not remain in Jahannam forever. It's possible that a believer who was aasi, disobedient, he goes into Jahannam for a period of time. That's possible. But is he going to remain in there forever?
No.
Never. Yes, jazakallah. He will never remain in there forever. But our objective should be, and we should all make this intention, that we are not going to spend any time in Jahannam. We are going to enter into the paradise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ Its width is like the distance of the sky and the earth, subhanallah. وَعِدَّةِ It has been prepared لِلْمُتَّقِينَ For the God-conscious ones. This Jannah, we have to aim to enter into it without any accountability, without any questioning, without any reckoning, without any punishment. How do we achieve all of this? We achieve it through the hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. His great companion, he narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ أَحَبَّ أَنْ يُزَحْزَحَ عَلِ النَّارِ وَيَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَلْتَأْتِهِ مَنِيَّتُهُ وَهُوَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَلْيَأْتِ إِلَى النَّاسِ الَّذِي يُحِبُّ أَنْ يُؤْتَى إِلَيْهِ The one who wants to be freed from Jahannam, which is what I just said. He doesn't want to go Jahannam full stop, period. He just wants to go straight into Jannah. The one who wants this, فَلْتَأْتِهِ مَنِيَّتُهُ Let death come to him. The time of death, وَهُوَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ If you believe in Allah and the last day and death comes to you like this, you will be freed from Jahannam and you will enter into paradise. Because this means there's iman in your heart like Shaykh Yaseen mentioned earlier. If you have this iman, even a small speck of it into your heart, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will forgive you for your sins. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will admit you into Jannah. And if you enter into Jannah, as soon as you step foot into Jannah, your first foot goes inside, you'll be given four glad tidings. A caller will call out, O people of Jannah, إِنَّ لَكُمْ أَن تَحْيُوا فَلَا تَمُوتُوا أَبَدًا For you is to live forever and ever, and you will never die. You're never going to die. You're not going to live for 1,000,000 years, or 2,000,000 years, or 1,000,000,000 years, or 1,000,000,000 years. You're going to live forever. Look up there, above that door. What do you see? That sign. Exit sign. What type of exit sign is it?
I don't know.
Fire exit. So if there's a fire, you go that way, right? To escape what? Death. The death, yeah. To escape death. Because in this dunya, you are vulnerable to death at any moment. You could die right now. In this halaqah. And if you die right now, this is considered by the ulama of Islam as a noble good death. The scholars, they say, what's considered a good death? They say one of three things. Either you die in a good action like this. So you're in the middle of a good action, you die like this. This is considered to be a good death. Or you die before the good action, or you die after the good action. So for example, before could be, you are making your way to the masjid, you are preparing to come for Salatul Maghrib or Salatul Isha, and then your sword is taken out. You have died before the good action, this is considered a good death. Or you die after the good action. You finish the prayer, you left the jalsa, you left the halaqah, you left the masjid, you're walking home, and then the person dies. This is considered to be a good death also. So Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, he said that the Prophet ﷺ, he said that the one who wants to be freed from Jahannam, and he wants to enter into Jannah, فَلْتَأْتِهِ مَنِيَّتُهُ وَهُوَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ This يوم الآخر, this akhirah, this home, this hereafter that we are heading to, when you look at the Qur'an and you look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about it, you'll be fascinated and amazed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He always describes this home to be a place where we are returning to. In the Arabic language, when you are speaking, you would say, ذَهَبْتُ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ وَرَجَعْتُ إِلَى الْبَيْتِ I went to the masjid and I returned home. وَذَهَبْتُ إِلَى الْعَمَلِ وَرَجَعْتُ إِلَى الْبَيْتِ And I went to work and I returned home. And you're not going to say, I went home and I returned to work. You're not going to say, I went home and I returned to the masjid. Because you don't live in the masjid, you don't live at work. You spend some time there and then you return home because this is your place of residence in this world. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every single time He spoke to us about the akhirah, He said, إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ جَمِيعًا And to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your return, all of you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ And you'll be returned back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, returned. As if you came from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you did come from Him. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ We belong to Allah. وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ And to Him, we shall return. So the first part of the hadith is, Death comes to you whilst you have complete belief in Allah and the last day. Then the Prophet ﷺ, he said, وَلْيَأْتِ إِلَى النَّاسِ الَّذِي يُحِبُّ أَنْ يُتَعِي. If you want to enter into Jannah and you want to be freed from Jahannam, it's not enough for you to only believe in Allah and the last day. You also have to uphold good character and good relationship with the people. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, deal with others the way you would like to be dealt with. We know of the hadith of the bankrupt person on the Day of Judgment. المفلس من أمتي من يأتي يوم القيامة بصلاة وصيام وزكاة ويأتي وقد شتم هذا وأكل مال هذا وضرب هذا وسفك دم هذا فيعطى هذا من حسناته وهذا من حسناته. The bankrupt person on the Day of Judgment, the Prophet ﷺ did not say, is not the one who abandoned worship. He's the one who engaged in a lot of worship. He came with salah and prayer and fasting and zakah and charity. And he came with a lot of good deeds. But he also came with a lot of oppression. He oppressed the slaves of Allah. He swore at this one and he slandered this one and he spilled the blood of this one and he hit this one. He oppressed the other one. So what happens? All of the good deeds he did that he was hoping to enter into Jannah with was taken away from him, was stripped away from him, and it was given to all of the people that he wronged. They all stood before him on the Day of Judgment and they took all of his good deeds. Imagine this. Imagine people coming before you. They didn't pray. They didn't do anything. They didn't worship Allah. You did all of this. But because you did not have a good relationship with them, they will take all of your good deeds. What happens after this? There are people who still have rights. They have more rights. And he has no more good deeds. So all of their bad deeds are taken and placed on him. Then the Prophet ﷺ, he said, ثُمَّ طُرِحَ فِي النَّارِ. And then he was thrown into Jahannam, cast into Jahannam forever. So, Akhirah, preparing for it, it involves those two parts. We heard some of the stations earlier. But we forget this other part of it as well. And this is the initial preparation for it. That you have a good relationship with Allah and you have a good relationship with the people. When you look at the Quran, you find, I'll ask you actually, do you find that Allah speaks to us more about having a good relationship with Him or having a good relationship with the people? What is mentioned more in the Quran? Having a good relationship with Allah or having a good relationship with people? Who knows the answer? I don't want the younger brothers, I want the adults. The adults should know. How can the adults be shy and the youngsters be confident? How can the adults not know and the youngsters know? This is very strange. And I hope this is not the case of people of Sheffield, because we heard a lot of good things about them. I hope the adults are not how they're portraying themselves to me. Hopefully you guys know, inshallah. Yes?
I think the elders.
The elders, sorry?
I think the elders.
The elders.
We should have a good relationship.
With the elders.
Oh, no, no. Wait, are we talking about Allah or the...
You didn't hear the question. So the adults, I will repeat my question. What is mentioned more in the Quran? Having a good relationship with Allah or having a good relationship with the people? What's mentioned more? I'm not going to take it from the younger brothers.
People.
Yes. The people. That's true. Allah mentions in the Quran to have good relationship with the people more than He mentions having a good relationship with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you look at how Allah spoke about the Akhirah in the Quran and how He spoke about the dunya in the Quran, it forces you to only strive and work for the Akhirah and forget and abandon and forsake this dunya. What dunya are you chasing when you are only here for 40, 50, 60, 70, 80 years maximum? And the moment you take your last breath and your soul is pulled out, every single thing that you had, all of your possessions, all of your money, all of your wealth, all of your authority, your position, your jah, everything you had is going to be taken away from you. You have nothing to your name. You are just a body, buried 6 feet under the ground. And the angels will be sent straight away to come down to the grave. Imma malaikatul adab wa imma malaikatul rahim. They are either going to be angels of mercy or angels of punishment. Everything you're trying to build, and these bitcoins and these crypto coins and all of these coins that you're investing in, none of them are going to buy you Jannah. It would be good if these apps that you have and you guys are checking it every hour, every day, every week, you're checking it. How has it gone up? Has it gone down? Is it a good time to take it out? Is it a good time to invest more in? And you're looking at it like this. It would be good if that you could invest into it and it can buy you Jannah. but it can't. The only thing that can buy you Jannah is your good actions. إِنَّ اللَّهَ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has purchased from the believers their souls and their wealth, and He made a transaction with you so He can give you paradise. When He spoke about the Akhirah in the Quran, He mentioned it 115 times. Akhirah, hereafter, is in the Quran 115 times. When He spoke about the dunya, He mentioned it in the Quran 115 times. That's a miracle in and within itself. The dunya and akhirah and their opposite things, they've been mentioned in the Quran the same amount of times. When He spoke about akhirah, He spoke about how permanent it is, how everlasting it is, how better it is. وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّن شَيْءٍ فَمَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. Everything that you have been given from this dunya, min shay'in, Allah says, every single thing, your wealth, your family, your wives, your husbands, your children, your parents, your money, your work, every single thing you have, فَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّن شَيْءٍ فَمَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. In another ayah, وَزِينَتُهَا. It's only an enjoyment that Allah gave it to you for a period of time. And it's also a zina. It's an adornment for this world. There's nothing more than this. Then Allah, He said, وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. But that which is with Allah, it is better. And that which is with Allah, it is more everlasting. How is it better? He never said. How is it everlasting? How long is it everlasting for? Is it absolute? Is it unrestricted? Allah didn't mention any of that. He's inviting you towards that. وَهُوَ الْغَفُورُ الْوَدُودُ. And He's the most forgiving and He's the most loving. He loves for you to be with Him. The believer, if he longs for the meeting with Allah, Allah longs for the meeting with him. Like the Prophet ﷺ, he said, مَنْ أَحَبَّ لِقَاءَ اللَّهِ أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ لِقَاءَهُ. Whomsoever loves the meeting with Allah, Allah will love to see him. And imagine if Allah loves to see you, Allah is longing to see you. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us those who love to meet Him. And in return, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be towards us one that loves to meet us. If Allah loves to meet you, you will be looking forward to His mercy. You will be looking forward to His kindness. You will be looking forward to His Jannah, that He only admits into it those who He showers His mercy with. I'm speaking about good actions. I'm speaking about the deen. I'm speaking about iman. I'm speaking about akhirah. I'm speaking about where we're all heading. And subhanAllah, you can't even enter into that place if you were to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from this moment until your final breath. In prostration, you don't even move from prostration. That doesn't equal Jannah as well. If you don't do any bad, you only do good, it still doesn't qualify that you enter into Jannah. Because the Sahaba, the companions, they asked the Messenger, Ya Rasulullah, are we able to enter into Jannah without good deeds? And he said, no one can enter into Jannah with their good deeds, nobody. What about you, O Messenger of Allah? Can you enter into Jannah with your good deeds? He said, Wala ana, not even me. So how do you enter into Jannah then? We've been told to worship Allah, but you can't enter into Jannah through your worship. So how do you enter into it? You enter into Jannah through the mercy of Allah, and that is it. يُدْخِلُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ فِي رَحْمَتِي. He will admit into His mercy those whom He has chosen. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, حَتَّى يَتَغَمَّدَنِ اللَّهُ بِرَحْمَتِي. Until Allah cloaks us with His mercy. So worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this iman you have, this is the greatest thing that Allah has given you. And the ni'mah, the blessing, the greater it is, the greater it is. If you misuse it, then the faster it will go and disappear. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about in the Quran, those who have believed, and they disbelieved, and they believed, and they disbelieved, how did He describe them? إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا ثُمَّ كَفَرُوا ثُمَّ آمَنُوا ثُمَّ كَفَرُوا ثُمَّ ازْدَادُوا كُفْرًا لَمْ يَكُنِ اللَّهُ لِيَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ وَلَا لِيَهْدِيَهُمْ سَبِيلًا بَشِّرِ الْمُنَافِقِينَ بِأَنَّ لَهُمْ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا. They believed and they disbelieved. They believed and they disbelieved. They believed and they disbelieved. They took their religion as a joke. They walk into Islam, they walk out of Islam. This is what they do. They practice when they feel like they want to practice. When they want to pray, they pray. When they don't want to pray, they don't want to pray. And they have forgotten that they are a slave. A slave is one who obeys his master. And if you want something from your master, the only way you get it is through that obedience. If Allah didn't have anything to give you, then you could do as you please. But because Jannah is on the line, why do you gamble? When Allah spoke of them, He concluded that ayah by saying, ثُمَّ ازْدَادُوا كُفْرًا لَمْ يَكُنِ اللَّهُ لِيَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ وَلَا لِيَهْدِيَهُمْ سَبِيلًا. They increased in their disbelief until it was not possible for Allah to forgive them or guide them to the straight path. بَشِّرِ الْمُنَافِقِينَ. Give glad tidings and declare, O Muhammad, to the hypocrites, that for them is a very painful punishment. So Jannah is true, like I mentioned before, and Jahannam is also true. I am just adding on to what Shaykh Yasin he said. Whilst the mercy of Allah exists, and we ask Allah to admit us into it, and its scope is very big, His mercy has preceded His wrath, like I mentioned, you have to be eligible for Allah's mercy. You can't just work in a job or a company. You can't just apply for something if you don't meet the requirements. Have you ever seen somebody applying for a job when he knows he's not going to get it? And if he does this, he's a silly person. He's wasting his time embarrassing himself. Why are you applying for this job? You are unlearned. Do you have the degree?
No.
You don't. You don't have the degree, right? So why would the person apply for it?
MashaAllah.
So a person doesn't do that with their dunya, but somehow, some way, this great man, this adult, he thinks he's just going to enter into Jannah, he's going to walk inside. And the Prophet ﷺ, he used to teach the Sahaba that this is not the correct understanding. This is not the correct understanding that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wants for His slaves to have. The Prophet ﷺ, he would speak to the Sahaba about Jannah and Paradise, and he would excite them. And then he will speak to them about Jahannam and the punishment of Allah. And so he will frighten them. And this is the balanced believer. He's balancing hope and fear. He's bouncing between the two. If you have too much hope, this is not good for you. It will ruin your hereafter. It will jeopardize it. Just like that, if you have too much fear and you're always scared, this is also bad. Some of the Salaf al-Salihin, the pious predecessors, what would they do? They would read the Quran. And they will come across verses speaking about the people of Jannah. They would smile as they're reading those verses, imagining that they are part of those people who Allah is describing. They will continue reading some verses later, some pages later, they will come across verses about punishment, and they'll start crying again, fearing that they may be from these people as well. And this is how the believer is. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about Jannah and Nar, like that in the Quran, He always coupled them together. نَبِّعْ عِبَادِي أَنِّي أَنَا الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ وَأَنَّ عَذَابِي هُوَ الْعَذَابُ الْأَلِيمُ. Inform my slaves, O Muhammad, that I, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am Ghafoor and I am Rahim. I am the most forgiving, I am the most merciful. But also inform them, O Muhammad, do not hide it from them, do not conceal it from them, do not withhold it from them, that I am the one who has a very severe punishment as well. Inform them about this. إِنَّ الْأَبْرَارَ لَفِي نَعِيمٍ وَإِنَّ الْفُجَّارَ لَفِي جَحِيمٍ. Inform them that the righteous will be in bliss, and inform them that the wrongdoers, they will be in torment. Inform them about both. Because Allah says in the Quran, you will either go right or you will go left. فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَفَرِيقٌ فِي السَّعِيرِ. So all of this is echoing what Shaykh Yasin said. But I wanted to add this hadith that I started with. And I'll say it again and I'll conclude my lecture there. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, مَنْ أَحَبَّ أَنْ يُزَحْزَحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَيَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ فلتأتي منيته وهو يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر وليأتي إلى الناس الذي يحب أن يؤتى إليه. The one who wants to be saved from Jahannam, let him ensure that when death comes to him, this universal concept agreed by every single man, every single woman, every single religion, the pious, the sinners, every single person knows that كل نفس ذائقة الموت. It is true. Even the atheist, even the Christian, even the Christian, even the Christian, even the Christian, even the Christian. I'm trying to wake you up because you're not listening. Young man, are you awake now? The Christian, I was trying to wake him up, he was sleeping. The Christian and the Sikh and the Jew and the atheist and the ones that have religion, the ones who don't, all of them, they all agree that we are going to die. Have you ever seen or heard anybody saying that you're not going to die? We all agree, every human knows this, but what we differ on is what happens next, correct? That's what we differ on, that's the truth. But it's an undeniable reality. It's an inevitable reality. كل من عليها فان ويبقى وجه ربك بالجلال والإكرام. every single thing on earth will be perished. The Prophet ﷺ, do you know what he said? He prophesied 1400 years ago that the angel that's going to blow the horn at the end of times, this angel has already placed his lips on the horn already. This is authentic hadith. He's waiting for the command. But since 1400 years ago, he already placed his lips on the horn. As soon as Allah says do it, he will do it. What's going to happen? Global death, global destruction. Everything will be destroyed. Nothing will be left. Everything, the masajid, the houses, every single thing will be gone. The animals, the mountains. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the mountains. What's going to happen? وَتَرَى الْجِبَالَ تَحْسَبُهَا جَامِدَةً وَهِيَ تَمُرُّ مُرَّ السَّحَابِ. These mountains, you see them very strong now. They are pegs on the earth. How firm is the mountain? How mighty is the mountain? You'll see this mountain moving right in front of you like you see the clouds. This is a reality that is ahead. And the ayat of the Quran are many regarding this. So the first part was to believe in Allah and the last day when death comes to you. And the last part was to deal with the people with good dealings and good etiquettes. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Jazakumullah khairan.